Good morning, everyone. Thanks for coming for this presentation. Today is my second presentation. I gave one yesterday about was Portuguese 100, not 101. The basic introduction to Portuguese in 50 minutes. And today I'll talk a little bit about the difference between the Brazilian and European Portuguese variants. Portuguese people, they don't like when I use this European Portuguese because we created the language. Why you call us European Portuguese? We're just Portuguese. But then, because we have the two variants, you need to specify which Portuguese you're talking about. And if you go to Portugal, they say, if you're Brazilian, you go to Portugal, they say Brazilians speak Brazilian, not Portuguese. Because so you changed the language so much. Okay, but let's talk a little bit. Before, this is a joke I made yesterday for my presentation. Just my last name is Italian, so Scapin is from Northern Italy, from Veneto. But here, people think I'm from France because of this play by Molière, Le Fibéry de Scapin. And then my first name is Rafael with F. This is like we're writing in Portuguese and Spanish. And then, in English, is like this. In French, it's like this. And then a joke I make here when I write my name to people, I do this. So you can choose if you want English or French. Okay. It's up to you. Parentheses on the trema, no issues. Okay, so why we have two variants of Portuguese? So if you're gonna learn Portuguese nowadays, like you go online to buy a book or anything, you're gonna find this. So Teach Yourself has the Brazilian Portuguese, Assimil, Le Portugais du Brésil. This is a Routledge colloquial Portuguese of Brazil. And then the Portuguese of Portugal. So why we have these two variants? The reason is, this is the origin of Portuguese. Portuguese was a language that was born, in Portugal initially, at this area over here. And then Portugal became a country. And then Galicia was part of Spain, so Galician language. It's like Portuguese, in fact, but written like in Spanish. So there's a, so this is the origin of the language. And then Portugal was, in the 1500s, the first Portuguese sailor came to Brazil. So Brazil was discovered by the Portuguese. Of course, Brazil existed before. There's indigenous people living there for thousands of years. But then officially the history starts when they discovered Brazil. 7,000 kilometers away from Portugal. Okay, so then Portuguese, they went to Africa, to Asia, to many, Japan as well, some Japanese words. Portuguese words went to Japanese. So, for example, arcangel in Japanese is arucanjo. That's arcanjo in Portuguese, just an example. So people say tempura could come from tempero, but this is not so well, there's a debate about this. So because of this, There was a geographic isolation here. At the time, there was no internet, nothing. So Brazil was separated by an ocean. And the Portuguese, when they came here, they were speaking the old Portuguese, like Portuguese from the 16th century, okay? So this Portuguese gave a lot of influence to Brazil. So then in Brazil also you have the indigenous people living there. Then the Africans came. So the Portuguese exported African people to work as slaves in Brazil. So we have this for 300 years. So, and then the Europeans start to come to Brazil. Brazil received a lot of immigrants from, especially from Europe, Italy, Germany, Poland. This gave rise to the Brazilian language. Okay, so the mix of all of this gave rise to the Brazilian language. So that's, we have a lot of influence from indigenous Africans and Europeans over there. So in Brazil, everybody's kind of an immigrant. So Brazilian passport is the most desired in the world because anyone can be a Brazilian, okay, physically speaking. Okay, so if you go to Brazil, each one of you here, you can pass by a Brazilian if you don't talk. Because as soon as you talk, they realize you're gringo, okay? Yeah, okay. So that's a big variety of Brazilian people. So nowadays, who speaks Portuguese? Portuguese, of course, spoken in Portugal, 10 million people in Brazil. This number is bigger now, 200 million people in Brazil. Then you have the African countries. You have Cabo Verde, Guinea-Bissau, São Tomé e Príncipe, Angola, Mozambique, and then in Asia, Timor-Leste. In China, we had Macau. There was a former Portuguese colony as well. But nowadays, most nobody speaks Portuguese over there. Only the old people speak Portuguese. Okay, so this gives you an idea how Portuguese. The number one, Brazil is the number one country that speaks Portuguese. Then you have Mozambique number two, Angola number three, Portugal number four. Okay? So, this is the origin of Portuguese, came from Latin, and then went to, we have these divisions here, the Ibero-Romance, then it gave rise to Portuguese and Spanish. They're the closest language, like closest language to Portuguese is Spanish. The third language close to Portuguese is Italian. Then you have French, and the far away one is Romanian, okay? Romania is interesting, because when I listen to Romanian, it looks to me like Italian mixed with Russian. Like it's kind of Slavic plus Latin language together. But you can understand a few words, but not a lot. This is the most spoken language in the world. Portuguese number six. Right now, these numbers are from this national encyclopedia from Wikipedia. I don't know how exact these numbers are, but it's from 2007. But gives an idea of this. In Montreal, Portuguese is the ninth most spoken language. Okay. Go to Montreal. There's a kind of Portuguese neighborhood in Montreal, close to Saint Laurent streets. So you can go there in the restaurants and you can talk. Most of the Portuguese that came to Montreal came from Azores, okay, an island in the Atlantic, belongs to Portugal. Okay, so let's see the main difference of Portuguese. Okay, the first one is the pronunciation. This is so like you see it right away. If you put a Portuguese here and a Brazilian. Like, even if you don't know any of the two variants, you're going to see the difference, listen to the difference right away. The prosody, the melody, the way, the singing of the language, okay? So they say that Brazilians, they sing when they speak, okay? The vocabulary as well, and the grammar, including the grammar. So there's a few things. So the way, like, Brazilians, they speak kind of a little bit slower than Portuguese, okay, and a bit more nasal, and pronounce all the vowels, okay. Portuguese from Portugal, it's not like this. So I'm gonna show you a difference. I'm gonna show you two singers from Brazil, Elis Regina and Tom Jobim, both are passed away. They're great singers. And then this is from Portugal, it's a group called Deolinda. They call what they call the New Fado, okay. So just to show you a little bit so that you see how the difference are. Let's go. Okay. Oh. All this advertisements. Águas de
março. É pau, é pedra, é o fim do caminho. É o resto de toco, é um pouco sozinho. É um caco de vidro, é a vida, é o sol. É a noite, é a morte, é o laço, é o anzol. É peroba do cão.
É o nó da madeira. É o mate da pereira.
É madeira de ferro.
É o tombo da ribanceira.
É o mistério profundo.
Chovendo, é conversa ribeira das águas de março. É o fim da canseira.
É o pé, é o chão.
É a mastradeira.
Sarinho na mão.
Pedra de atiradeira.
É uma ave no céu.
É uma ave no chão.
É um regato, é uma fonte.
É um pedaço de pão.
É o fim do pulso, é o fim do caminho. No rosto, desgosto, é um pouco sozinho.
Okay, just to give an idea, so you can see the melody of Brazilian. I'm going to put the Portuguese one version right now. This group called the Deolinda.
Oh.
Olha a banda filarmônica tocar na minha rua. Vai na banda, oh meu amor, a soprar a sua tuba. Ele já tocou trombone, clarinete e ferrinhos. Só lhe falta o meu nome suspirado aos meus ouvidos. Toda a gente fã, 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 só lhes dizem o que eu digo. Que tuba fã, 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 tem tão pouco romantismo. Mas eu toco a fã, 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 e o meu coração rendido só responde fã, 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 com ternura e carinho. Os meus pais já me disseram: oh filha, não sejas louca, que as variações de goba, golem, golem, que são boas.
Notice the difference, even for those who don't speak Portuguese yet? Is it like striking difference? Yeah, it is. Like, it's very different, in fact. Just to show you, like people talking now, because if we're singing, oh gosh. That happens from time to time. I don't know why.
Beleza? Antes de começar, vou pedir para botar o celular para vibrar, que é importante, né? Botar o celular aí para não tocar, silencioso já é o suficiente. Dizer que não pode filmar, mas pode tirar foto, com flash, sem flash, durante, antes, pode tirar quando quiser, tem importância. Dizer também que a peça não é interativa, que eu senti um cagaço dessa regiãozinha aqui. Mas vai dar tudo certo, tá, gente? Não tem nada de participação, nada disso, tá? Dizer também o negócio da instrução de incêndio, o pessoal pergunta muito: ah, se pegar fogo, eu faço, pegou fogo, você corre, tá? Que é o que eu farei, inclusive. Só que é perigoso essa carpetada, extintor de incêndio, tem um daquele lado, um daquele outro, um no fundo, e assim, um é pó químico, um é gás carbônico, um é água, ou seja, duas pessoas vão morrer, entendeu? Então não tente chapar, que é uma loucura, esses três tipos de...
Yeah, this is a famous Brazilian comedian, a stand-up comedian. This is a Portuguese comedian called Ricardo Araújo Pereira.
És a primeira pessoa a sentar-se no nosso sofá. O que é que te parece?
Opa, é uma honra que eu não... estimarei para sempre. Para sempre.
Repara só, deixa-me só explicar. Repara nos adereços bonitos que me puseram aqui.
Isso é ótimo, de facto.
Serve para...
Mas há um pormenor ainda, não sei se já reparaste, que alguém pôs uma fita cola por cima, que é para tu não partires essa...
Claro, claramente, lá está.
Nota-se que eu estou profundamente desconfortável.
Sim. Mas não por causa do sofá.
Mas fisicamente não. Ou emocionalmente?
Não, tudo.
O que é que podemos fazer para te tornar mais confortável, Ricardo?
Ah, ocorrem-me duas com três coisas, mas não, infelizmente não.
Pronto, ok, esse cá então não vai dar.
Deixa-me só dizer-te uma coisa que é interessante. Tu disseste isto antes do intervalo, mas vocês dois andaram no mesmo colégio.
For those who are learning Brazilian Portuguese, do you understand most of this, what they're talking about, or like, no? It's a little bit more complicated? Yeah. Don't be ashamed, like, even for Brazilians sometimes, it's kind of, yeah, difficult to... Because Brazil is not exposed to Portuguese. Like, if you go to Brazil, you don't find anything from Portugal on Brazilian television. Not on movies, zero. Music, zero. Literature, a little bit, after Saramago and all these great writers. But nothing. If you go to Portugal, on the other side, you find a lot of stuff from Brazil. So Brazilians, they are watching Brazilian TV for more than 40 years, 50 years. So they know a lot of these language you use, the expressions you use, but not vice versa. So if a Portuguese person goes to Brazil and talk like using expressions they use in Portugal, Brazilians are going to look like, sorry, what is this? You can understand the basic, the standard. If you don't use like slang or anything, we can have a conversation. But for like an average Brazilian, if they use slangs and stuff, it's kind of difficult because there is no exchange. Years ago, so that you know, on the public Brazilian television, there was a Brazilian Portuguese teenager soap opera kind of TV show. And I was so excited because you don't find anything from Portugal on the public Brazilian television. So I was there watching. Then it was doubled in Brazilian Portuguese. I was like, what? So I sent an email to the TV and said, why you guys did that? Well, I like to listen to Portuguese from Portugal. That, you know, the sponsors, they asked this for us. Because they were afraid Brazilians would not understand, like, the language. Like, whoa, this is so sad, you know? Yeah, so... to the level it happens, so it's kind of complicated. Okay, the rhythm is also different. And the difference here is what we call the speech rhythm. Okay, each language has its own speech rhythm. And the Brazilian Portuguese can be classified as a syllable-timed language, whereas European Portuguese is a stress-timed language. So in Brazil, we pronounce all the syllables. It is funny because some English words, let's say Facebook, Brazilians, they pronounce like Facebook. Okay, Instagram. Okay, Snapchat. Okay, so they pronounce every syllable like this. Where in Portugal, they don't. Okay, so take a look at this. Languages that are syllable timed, like French is one, Italian, Romanian, Spanish, and strangely, Icelandic, which is a Scandinavian language. But take a look at the stress time language, English, German, Dutch, Danish, Swedish, just to name a few, Norwegian, Faroese. So Portuguese is here, European Portuguese is here, okay? That explains the difference, like in speech, like in the rhythm, when they talk. So Brazilians, the other side, with the other Latin languages, okay? But strangely, the evolution, the phonetic evolution in Portugal was very different than the one that happened in Brazil, and they are here, okay? So they're more closer to English when you speak than the other Latin languages. Yes? For sure, and we have there are some proofs about this for sure. So Brazilian Portuguese is what we call the old Portuguese, like Quebecois is kind of old French. There's a famous writer, Portuguese writer from the 16th century, Camões, Luís de Camões. Camões wrote several poems in the 16th century. If you ask to a Brazilian, a modern Brazilian, to read the poems, the metric is okay. If you ask to a modern Portuguese to read the same, the metric does not match. That proves the evolution that happened. It's one of the proofs. I mean, there are many others. But yeah, they evolved differently. So they brought the language to Brazil, then was there, and then there was a lot of influence from other things. And the evolution in Portugal was very different, very different. So phonetically, there was a big difference. Okay, like French from here, you can see the same thing. People say that old French, they pronounce it bien, they pronounce it bien. That was the pronunciation, like in old French, bien, not bien. Bien is a modern, it's an evolution of this pronunciation. The same happened kind of in Brazil. Okay, so in Brazilian Portuguese, all the syllables have quite the same duration. Okay, and in European Portuguese, the unstressed syllables are shorter and sometimes they disappear. Okay. So they're going to say the name of the country, for example, Portugal. In Brazil, you say Portugal. By the way, the L at the end in Brazilian Portuguese, we don't pronounce like all, we pronounce like U. For example, my name in Brazil, we pronounce like Rafael. Not Rafael, no, doesn't exist. So the L at the end becomes U, never in Portugal. So, and then they pronounce like in Portugal, the name of the country be Portugal, Portugal. So, sometimes disappear, okay? So in consequence, in European Portuguese, they're more closed syllables, where in Brazilian Portuguese, they open more the syllables, okay? In Brazilian Portuguese, also, the syllables have the same intonation. In the European, the unstressed syllables, we reduce it and frequently elided, so they're gonna kind of disappear. So this is the IPA notation for some phrases in the two languages. So you have, for example, the first one, I'll read like a Brazilian, Portugal é país bonito. Portugal is a beautiful country. A Portuguese would read this like, Portugal é país bonito. Look at the disappearance of some sounds here. Look, Portugal, there's like the U kind of disappear. Okay? Whereas in Brazilian Portuguese, Portugal é país bonito. The O becomes U, okay? We write bonito, but we pronounce bonito. Bonito. Look at that. Bonito. This is IPA, showing how the pronunciation is. A menina faltou ao teste de psicologia. The girl missed the psychology test. Look, menina faltou ao teste de psicologia. Portugal. In Brazilian, a menina faltou. Look at the L. The L becomes U, it's a W in IPA, faltou. In Portugal, faltou, okay? Ao teste, teste, this is another thing, we don't pronounce teste, teste, ch, ch, ch. Okay? So the T becomes ch, like the D becomes z, dia, We don't say dia, dia, gi, gi, in Brazilian Portuguese. Okay? O papel do estudante rasgou-se. O papel do estudante rasgou-se. O papel, ou becomes you, o papel, papel do estudante rasgou-se, rasgou-se, si. Nobre povo, nação, valente e imortal. This is the first line of the Portuguese anthem. Nobre povo, nação, valente, valente e imortal. Valente e imortal. Nobre povo, nação, valente e imortal. Valente. E imortal. See the difference? When you put the IPA side to side, you see more. I mean, you can literally see instead of listening, but just to show the change we have. Okay? Plus, in Brazil, you have many different accents. I'm just showing you like the most famous ones. Okay? So you have the one from Minas Gerais. It's called the Mineiro. Someone who lives in Minas Gerais is a Mineiro. This is strange because Mineiro is a profession, but became the name of a person like Brasileiro. Brazilian in Portuguese is Brasileiro. Brasileiro was the profession of those people who used to cut a tree called Pau Brasil. Okay, there was a tree in Brazil. They used to color, to extract like a substance that to color like clothes and stuff. That was red. It's called Pau Brasil. P-A-U. Dash Brasil, Pau Brasil. And the person who used to cut this tree was called the Brasileiro, was a profession. Because this in Portuguese, the eiro is a profession. O padeiro, marceneiro, all professions. But became the name of the people who lived there. Okay, then you have one from Bahia, baiano. One from Rio called the carioca. This is an indigenous word. Okay, oca in Tupi language is an old indigenous Brazilian language means house, and cari means, I think, white. So the people who lives, the white people who lives in that house, because Portuguese were there. And then you have from São Paulo, okay? And then one from southern Brazil called gaúcho. So they're very different from each other. For Brazilians, like, you know right away when someone is from one of these areas here. It's very, they're different, okay? The melody changes and everything changes. I don't know if you're learning the language, you can like make the distinction right away, but as soon as you go more into the language, you're gonna see like those variations. They're very clear for you. So I'm gonna put you some for so start with the Mineiro. It's a very funny one for us.
Então vem cá. Quando você veio para São Paulo, as pessoas achavam você assim um pouco diferente por causa do sotaque.
O povo achava que eu era caipira demais. E eu sofri muito por causa da minha caipirez.
Mas eles entendiam o que você falava, por exemplo?
Às vezes não. Por quê? Qual é as palavras que você queria saber?
Eu queria fazer uma brincadeira com você. A produção me passou aqui umas perguntas, umas palavras estranhas, que eu também não consegui entender muito bem. Mas você topa fazer uma brincadeira? Você, né?
Pode, pode falar.
Não é de sexo não, tá?
Tá.
Então coloca aí. Preparada?
O quê? Você vai fazer ditado?
Faz assim, ó. Essa palavra. Pelejano. O que quer dizer?
Ué, pelejano?
Eu não sei o que
é. Pelejano é pelejano, é assim. Tá labutando.
Quê?
Labutando. Tá trabalhando, tá trabalhando.
Tá na luta.
Tá pelejando.
Pelejano.
Tá levando a vida, pelejando.
Tá pelejando. Alguém aqui sabe o que quer dizer emes?
É mesa, é mesa.
É mesa, é mesa. É mesa, é mesa.
É mesa é o quê?
É mesa. É mesa.
É mesa.
É mesa.
É, ué, é mesa.
O que quer dizer é mesa?
Olha, ela tá querendo dizer é mesa, não.
É mesa?
Ué,
é. É tipo, é mesmo?
É mesa.
Ah, é mesa. Entendi.
Okay, just to show you this, let's go to another one. Let's go to the baiano. Very.
A paquera é diferente. A bonita vem, que nem essas bailarinas assim, ó. Ó, jogando, ó, ó. A feia fica olhando assim, ó. Ó, secando ela, tá vendo? E o que é que acontece? Na Bahia, a paquera é assim, ó. O baiano paquerando, ele olha. Pra entender baiano paquerando, só baiano mesmo. Ele fala assim, ó.
Ô, véi, ô, véi.
Vem, para. Ele tá recebendo uma entidade. Para lá, meu irmão. E o que não vê faz... Rapaz, quando os dois chegam na bonita, os dois vão pra bonita, a fé sobra, não é verdade?
Isso.
A fé... Acontece que a fé, que é a dona do carro, ela faz... Patrícia, vamos embora. Aí, meu filho, isso é a verdade. Porque o cara que tá pegando a bonita... Ele desconsidera o colega. Ele sabe que a outra é uma muqueca. Ele olha pro colega e faz...
A outra aí, né? Aí.
Rapaz! Tem outra situação que eu quero lhe contar?
Ok, so a little bit about baiano. Can you notice the difference? I'll put two together now. The one from São Paulo and Rio together.
Não acredito!
Rodrigo e Patrícia!
Nosso nome é Patrícia e Rodrigo. Foi o que eu disse, a Patrícia ama.
Onde é que vocês estão ficando aí, ó?
A gente tá ficando no Grand Palladium Occidental Rio.
Tô na casa de um brother, com os brothers, dormindo lá.
É, tá mó maneiro.
Aí como é que vocês descobriram essa praia aqui?
É um site, tem dicas de hotel. Restaurantes.
E olha, tem o app deles no iPhone novo.
Ah, não, a gente conheceu um rasta, sacou na estrada, né, amor?
Boladão.
Ele deu uma dica, brother, uma trilhazinha, a rua a gente dá na praia deserta.
Sinistra.
Nossa grande descoberta foi um bistrô. Conta pra eles, Morzão.
Meu, um bistrô, meu.
Uma quiche de cerveja.
Maneira.
Obrigado,
é que vocês têm cerveja? Claro, meu, está com o cooler.
Tô numa olaria, que você puder dar uma parada pra comer aí, ó.
É, meu, tem um cooler aqui, preciso tomar mal cuidado, que senão eu perco a mão aqui, que sai um
defeito, né?
Tem aqui uma coisinha pra você, ó.
Maçã estranha, bro.
Banana maçã.
Deve ser.
Vem cá, sabe que ó, o sol tá castigando, hein? Se quiser blondo, a gente tá naquela barraca ali, ó.
Se quiser minha prancha pra tu, de repente, dar um tchum, só
que... Oh, não.
Obrigado, ó, vou passar dessa vez, hein? Que a gente tá aqui já com os nossos gadgets, que já, ó, tem tudo aqui que precisa. Vou passar vários de dentro, né,
Luzão? Cheia. Bom, vambora.
Ok, it's a little bit of... It is right there, it's so different. And then the last one, the gaúcho one, Southern Brazil.
No vídeo de hoje, eu vou falar coisas que todo gaúcho fala, mas só gaúcho é que entende. E como eu sou um taura bagual por demais, eu vou traduzir para os viventes que não tiveram o privilégio de nascer aqui, mas que querem aprender o idioma mais culto do mundo. Sabe qual? O gauchês. É isso aí. É praticamente um gauchês com a tecla SAP. Confere isso aí. Baita chinelão. Que chinelagem. Me caiu os guteados do bolso. Bah! Bá, 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 capaz, mas bem capaz. Hoje eu tô atucanado. Vou ali no bolicho. Me vê 10 cacetinhos. Sai uma torrada aí. 2 quilos de vazio. Neste frio de ringue acústico, só usando cuecão, 2 abrigos e 1 japona, né?
So there's like many different expressions and words they use there. And basically, he's speaking this in gauchês, and it's translated in standard Portuguese so people can understand. So, but you see the intonation, like, how it changed too? So it's very different too. Okay. This is a funny thing. I don't know if I put it like this. Guy's made some accents from São Paulo.
Tem uma coisa. Pô, diz, o carioca diz que o paulista tem um sotaque só. Tem o paulista italiano que fala assim, que é da Moca, que tem um sotaque mais puxado de Catanduva. Tem o paulista, que é o paulista interior, que fala porta, corte, morte, sorte, forte. Né? Que é o paulista que deve falar inglês, exatamente é esse, né? Caraíra, Piracicaba is near or far, né? E tem também o sotaque da. E tem o nasalês de São Paulo. O nasalês é aquela menina que faleceu, a Juliana, e tem 25 anos. E tem por último também o sotaque da periferia. O sotaque da periferia de São Paulo. Porque na periferia de São Paulo a voz das pessoas vai ficando grave. Posso usar esse microfone aqui?
Pode, claro.
Que a voz das pessoas na periferia de São Paulo vai tipo.
Oh, viagem, mano, tudo certo, mano. Inclusive, mano, quando eu falo assim com essa voz. Dá mó vontade de rimar, certo?
E no Rio, só tem um sotaque?
No Rio de Janeiro tem uma coisa legal que é o seguinte. O sotaque do carioca facilita você conseguir certos favores, sabe?
Por exemplo, se você chegar aqui em São Paulo educadamente e pedir, ah, por favor, Alex, você poderia me trazer mais uma canequinha d'água, por favor? Ele provavelmente... Não, não me atenda, não, porque o carioca agora tu vai atender.
Porque, assim, peraí,
agora que o carioca, essa é a diferença. O carioca vem e fala assim, aí, cumpade, ou da gravata, traz a caneca aí pra mim, deixa essa caneca aí, cumpade. Bora, traz logo aí, irmão. Vambora com o bagulho aí, cumpade. Vou ficar neurótico aqui, irmão. Vamos aí. Valeu, valeu, valeu. Já.
So, it shows the difference. It's so funny. This guy is it's a very good comedian in Brazil. So, we also have a lot of difference in vocabulary between both countries, and before I went to Portugal, I went to Portugal 2 years ago for the first time in my life, but of course I was prepared, because I bought some dictionaries, kind of mini dictionaries to understand and all that stuff, so I knew all this stuff. But I think the average Brazilian don't care about this kind of thing. So for example, washroom, in Brazil you say banheiro, in Portugal, casa de banho. We never use casa de banho in Brazil, it doesn't exist. Like a little a coffee, like espresso, would be cafezinho in Brazil. In Portugal, bica. See the difference? A line in Brazil is a fila. In Portugal, bicha. The only issue, like bicha in Brazilian, is like is a slang for a homosexual person. Okay, so male man, yeah, bicha in Brazil. So in Portugal, this is a line. So imagine if you go or go to the line or go to the bicha. Kind of strange. Bus in Brazil is ônibus, in Portugal autocarro. Train in Brazil is trem, in Portugal comboio. Nothing to do with the Brazilian thing. A screen, a TV screen in Brazil is tela. Tela would be like a painting, and in Portugal is ecrã, but they pronounce like it came from French, but they pronounce ecrã, not écran. Ecrã. Cool in Brazil is legal, in Portugal is fiche. Okay, so if you're gonna have a, like a beer, a shop in Brazil is like shop, in Portugal is imperial. Call it a cup of tea. In Brazil, xícara, in Portugal, chávena. See the big difference. Juice in Brazil, suco, Portugal, sumo. A straw in Brazil is canudinho, in Portugal, palhinha, which is more like in French. Like the translation to French, it's the real translation from English. Straw would be palhinha. This is funny. Sorvete, ice cream in Brazil is sorvete. It doesn't matter if it's sorbet or ice cream is sorvete. Portugal, gelado. The place you go to have ice cream in Brazil is called a sorveteria. In Portugal, geladeria. Okay, yes. And there are many other ones. Like, for example, breakfast in Brazil is like café da manhã. And Portugal is a literal translation from French. Pequeno almoço. Petit déjeuner. Literally translated from French. Okay, this does not exist in Brazil. If you say pequeno almoço, people look at you, you want to have lunch? Like, they don't associate with this. And cell phone in Brazil is like celular. In Portugal, telemóvel. Okay, so there's some difference that make the language, for example, X-Files, this TV series in Brazil is like Arquivo X. In Portugal, Ficheiros Secretos. Even names like movies, okay, they translate differently. I don't know who have seen this Hitchcock movie called Vertigo. Vertigo, long time ago. In Brazil, it's called Vertigo. In Portugal, The Lady Who Died Twice. So they told the script. They revealed the script. That's true, you know? That's so funny. This is a very interesting thing, too. In Brazil, this is the lady, Our Lady of Aparecida, is the patroness of Brazil. So it's celebrated on October 12. So in Brazil, Aparecida means... you appeared from, because this statue here was discovered by some fishermen in 1785, I think, in Brazil. And it just appeared when they were like fishing, and then the statue appeared. So they gave the name Aparecida, that became a female name, female first name in Brazil. Only in Brazil, in Portugal, they don't have it. Okay? So Aparecida in Brazil is a name, and it's a short for Sida. So if you call Aparecida, most of the people are going to call you Sida. It's like, cute, you know, oh, Sida, how are you? Okay, because of this, the name for AIDS in Brazil, Brazil cannot use this. You know, in Portugal, AIDS is SIDA, like in most of the Latin languages. This is a translation, literally translation of the English one. So Brazil, because of this, decided to use English for AIDS. So imagine, you know, like it's kind of complicated. Other difference. This is the washroom in Brazil. We call it banheiro. Okay, the washroom is called banheiro. And the bathtub is called banheira. Okay, so banheiro is the place, the washroom you go. And the bathtub is called banheira. In Portugal, banheiro is casa de banho. Why? Because banheiro in Portugal is the male lifeguard. And banheira is the female lifeguard. That's right. If you remember Portuguese, the eiro is a profession. Remember? Brasileiro was a profession. You see, this is so funny for us. Like, you listen to this, like, wow. You know, but this is true. It exists. Okay? And Portugal, there are many accents in Portugal as well, not only in Brazil. So Portugal is a small country. Like, you can go from southern Portugal to northern maybe in 2 hours driving, you know. 10 million people, not a lot. But they have a lot of accents because they're old, you know. Many, many accents in Portugal. So I'm going to show you some Portuguese accents now, just a little bit.
Aqui. A
portuguesa.
He starts with the southern accent from Algarve, okay, southern Portugal. Usually there, people speak a little bit slower, a little bit, for Portuguese standards.
Os sotaques, não é?
Mas o sotaque típico algarvio é tão bom que eu por vezes não entendo nada, que é nada mais nada menos do que assim. As pessoas aqui no Algarve não falam todas de maneira esquisita, a gente andamos aí todos marafados, a gente vai ali a Portimão e só se ouve falar em marafados e essas coisas, não percebe nada disso. Também não percebe nada do que eles dizem. E não é? É. Claro que no Algarve também existe uma coisa que está tecnicamente associada ao turismo, que temos, digamos, dois sotaques que englobam parte do turismo. Temos a parte dos que vêm para cá, que são nada mais nada menos do que os imigrantes, aqueles portugueses que acham que sabem falar francês e misturam português com francês ao mesmo tempo, e dá isto.
Jean-Pierre Vinci! Jean-Pierre! Acho filho da p***, estou a falar de quê?
E depois, claro, temos o português das pessoas que recebem, mais precisamente aqueles que acolhem as pessoas do turismo, que não sabem falar a língua e, por isso, inventam uma espécie de um português só que para surdos e, às vezes, um pouco invertido. Pode ser que eles percebam assim. Bom dia! Ah, amigo, então, como é que é, pá? O que é que vai desejar? Então, o que é que vai desejar, amigo?
Ah, sorry, I don't speak Brazilian.
Mas qual brasileiro? Qual? Que pá, estamos em, olha, Portugal, sabes o que é isso? Ah, tu és estrangeiro, olha, deixa até que eu já te foto. Oh, então, o que é que queres beber? Queres o quê? Brandy! Não? Não queres? Olha, tens jeans! Não, também não. Opa, também tu és um lixado. Olha, queres o quê? Olha, tequila, sabes o que é?
Oh, sorry, I don't understand.
Olha, queres o quê? Queres mesmo, amigo, é? Então toma lá que aqui, ó, acabadinho de fazer, toma lá, não me chateis mais o resto do dia. Yes, please, yes, please. Cheers, thank you.
E avançando então um bocadinho mais para cima, temos um sotaque tipicamente alentejano.
Então, a vida aqui no Alentejo é muito complicada. A gente trabalha, mas a gente dorme. A gente come, mas também dorme. É uma vida muito complicada. Olha, vou dormir outra vez, porra. Espera, antes de dormir, com licença. Espero que mames como eu te amo. Ouviste? Porra. Daqui, o Zé Lelito está a dizer que gosta muito de ti, porra. Agora vou dormir.
It goes like for more 10 minutes or so. This it's so good, this one. It's the guy really. Besides all this difference, there's also grammar difference between both variants of Portuguese. So, for example, in Portugal, they use this two for the second person, informal one. So for your friends and family, you use this. In Brazil, only in specific regions, they use two. Like in southern Brazil, for example, they use it, but it's not all in Brazil. So, yes, exactly. So they use two, but they conjugate with você, like the third person. So two is second person, singular. They conjugate with the third. So, yeah. In Brazil, almost in the entire country use você for everyone. It doesn't matter if it's your family, friends, person you don't know. But a person you don't know, we created this one. We say if it's a man, it's o senhor or a senhora. So if I go to the streets in Brazil and I'm going to ask information, if it's a man, o senhor pode me ajudar. Or if it's a woman, a senhora, if it's, you know, depends. If it's not so old, we say senhorita. Okay? Plus, in Portugal, in Brazil, we use a lot of gerunds, like estou comendo, I'm eating. Portugal, estou a comer. Okay? So this is another difference that we have as well. Another is the object pronouns. Like in Brazilian Portuguese, we use most of the times at the beginning. For example, we never say in Brazil, amo-te, like they use in Portugal. We always say, te amo. Okay? For example, if you're going to go to me dá café. In Portugal, dê-me café. Dê-me. In Brazil, me dá. It's this use here after, like especially when you're asking for something or ask, it's always at the beginning in Portuguese, in Brazilian Portuguese. Okay? It's another difference that we have. And personally, I think it looks like for me, te amo is look better than amo-te. Amote, you look at this in Brazil, doesn't look so cute. Like in Spanish, it's like this, in Italian, it's like this, right? So all the other Latin languages, like they have the same. Why in Portugal they use the other one? Like, I don't know. Yeah. Yes, but they don't have the object pronouns. They use the you, the regular pronoun. Another thing is the orthography. We have two orthographies of Portuguese, like you have in English, right? There's the British orthography, where guys write center, R-E at the end, and the American one, E-R. For example, in Brazil, we have two, but we're trying to unify both orthographies, but it's impossible for some reasons, okay? So the last one was the orthographic agreement of 1990, were many words, they changed it, but this affected 1.6% of the words in European Portuguese and only half, 0.5% in Brazil. The thing we it's difficult to change this is this. For example, a fact in Portuguese, in Brazil, is a fato. Fato, okay, is a fact. In Portugal, is facto. They still preserve the C for one reason. Fato in Portuguese, in European Portuguese, is suit, okay, like a tuxedo thing. They cannot get rid of the C, okay? If they get rid of the C, it becomes another word, okay? And because of this, it's almost impossible to unify both orthography. So they're still gonna write stuff like this, okay? The accents as well, for example, economico, we put a circumflex. In Brazil, Portugal, they put an acute, okay? So when you're learning the variants, you need to pay attention to this as well. Okay, so change also this kind of thing. There is what we call the community of Portuguese language speaking countries called the Comunidade dos Países de Língua Portuguesa, CPLP. You guys can go to this website here, cplp.org, and has a lot of information, interesting information about Portuguese language and stuff. And to finish this, I'd like to show you, it's a Portuguese poem read in different accents. Okay, this is, it's a poem by a Portuguese writer called Walter Ugumai. Okay, I don't know if you know, this guy is very famous in Portugal and Brazil too. It's a beautiful poem. So people from all over the world who speaks Portuguese are reading this. And then I finish my... Thank you.
reparei desde pequena que os adultos vivem muito em casais.
Mesmo que nem sempre sejam óbvios.
Porque algumas pessoas têm par, mas andam avulsas, como as solteiras.
Há casais de mulher com homem, há de homem com homem e outros de mulher com mulher.
Há também casais de pássaros, coelhos, elefantes, besouros, pinguins, que são absurdamente fiéis.
Quer dizer, há casais de pinguins e até golfinhos podem ser casais. Tudo por causa de amor.
O amor constrói. Gostamos de alguém mesmo quando estamos parados.
Durante o tempo de dormir, é como fazer treino ou cozinhar.
Para mesas de mil lugares. Mas amar é um trabalho bom, a minha mãe diz.
Vivo num lugar quente.
Aqui tem muitos mosquitos e encontramos borboletas nas flores.
No verão, abrimos as janelas cobertas com redes.
Ficamos a ver todo o quadro por esta brancura.
Também há gatos soltos e outros dentro das casas.
Os gatos soltos são os nossos.
Nós não temos outros. Eles entram no quintal e levam os restos. Andam em belas estreitas.
Todos os gumes são estradas para eles. Sabem não cair e quando caem, sabem cair.
Alguns casais de bicho também são pinguim homem com pinguim homem.
Ou golfinho mulher com golfinho mulher. Mas eu nunca vi e não tenho provas.
Nunca sequer vi um pinguim ou um golfinho. E fico triste por isso. Os gatos são casais misturados?
Eu acho. Não são fiéis. Os cachorros também não. São fiéis aos donos, mas, entre si, não namoram com muito cuidado.
A minha mãe explicou que o amor também é namorar com cuidado.
Eu adoraria ver jacarés, ursos brancos ou cobras de 10 metros.
Uma vizinha da nossa rua tem uma vaidosa galinha da Angola.
Going to stop here because this goes for 14 minutes, so you guys can I'll send this presentation later so you can have access, so you can go. It is a beautiful poem I like reading for people. So I'm going to open for questions now, so we're almost at the end. We have 10 minutes. I'll leave my contacts here for those who want to contact me, my email, Twitter, and my Facebook, so feel free to connect with me. And I open for questions if you have any questions now. Yes. What?
What kind of Brazilian do you speak?
I was born in the countryside of São Paulo, so I speak Paulista. Yes. And yeah, if you go on Brazilian television, there is kind of a standard Brazilian TV spoken language. It's a mix between Rio and São Paulo, okay? It's kind of an artificial thing. Nobody speaks like that, but it's made for TV. You need to speak like a standard language. You cannot speak like on the street. So Brazil has it's a country, have a diglossia thing. Like we have kind of two languages, like have the standard language, like official, like people speak on TV and stuff. And you have the language speak at home on streets and stuff. Yes. More than Portugal, for sure. Yes. Miami.
Without pronouncing the E at all.
Could be something local. I would pronounce it, a Brazilian would pronounce it Miami. Miami.
Miami.
Miami. Like a Facebook. Facebook. Yeah. LinkedIn. LinkedIn. Yes, that's how they pronounce it. Yes, exactly. That's another, this is a Portuguese thing. Like, usually at the end of the word, it kind of vanish a little bit. Okay, but we pronounce. In Portugal, it disappears. There's a difference between pronouncing softly and disappear.
Okay.
Yeah. Yes.
So, I'm not entirely sure, but when I listen to the Brazilian side, I've heard a lot of European Portuguese.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah. It is different. Yeah, it is different. The intonation, the melody, it's different. The evolution, yeah.
Not just at the syllable level, but I think at the level of the whole.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, that changed too. Good, yes. Sure. Yeah. Oh, my LinkedIn, not my LinkedIn. Yeah, you go R Skipin, you find in all social media my nickname is R Skipin, okay? Or R Escaping. Not escaping, but yes. In Africa, it's more like from Portugal, the accent from Portugal. For us, when you listen to Mozambique, Angola, Cabo Verde, Guinea-Bissau, it has a very strong Portuguese influence, but it's there's a lot of Creoles as well. So, in fact, for example, in Mozambique, it's the second biggest country, Portuguese-speaking country. Mozambique has a lot of... It's a second language for many people there, because the first language is the local dialect, local languages, and then they use Portuguese to unify the country to so that people can understand each other, because they have different tribes and stuff. So they, Angola is the same, but it's more Portuguese from Portugal. They use the Portuguese writing orthography instead of the Brazilian, but sorry. Yes, exactly, you're right, yeah. But Brazil, for example, when East Timor became a country, became independent, Brazil sent a lot of teachers, Portuguese teachers, there to teach them. And in Portugal, it's kind of a scandal, like, because it was a former colony, Portuguese colony until 75 or 74, and then Brazilians are saying they're going to teach Brazilian Portuguese over there. No, we should teach Portuguese from Portugal there. So there's kind of a debate in Portugal, right? You know, but at the end, you know, it was okay. So people are teaching and, you know, that's it. Yes, first. Not word order, but as I mentioned to you, the pronouns, for example, we usually use at the beginning of the phrase, but not word order. It's a SVO language and SVO for everything. So, I mean, you can read a book in Portuguese from Portugal and Brazil. It's not the two languages, you know, but there's certain words and certain ways to write things. When I read Portuguese from Portugal, a newspaper, for example, I find they use more precise words to define like something in the text. Whereas in Brazil, people kind of use like more generic words, because I don't know if the literacy of people are not so, I don't know, it's different. You see this right away. Okay, yeah, that's my personal impression. Yeah. Other question? Yeah. In Portugal, that's a good question. In Portugal, they say there's a kind of standard Portuguese language would be like in Coimbra, okay, in the University of Coimbra. That's one of the second oldest European university. Okay, it's in Coimbra. It's 1 hour from Lisbon. Okay, that would be a place, and it's a small place, like 100,000 people live there, close to Lisbon, close to Porto. It's could be a good place to study Portuguese. Plus, the accent is more neutral. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. For sure. I would recommend you go there because it's kind of neutral thing. Yeah. Yeah. I'll tell you a story. In 1946, 47, there is a Hungarian translator who decided to move. He was a teacher of French, Italian, Latin at a time in Budapest. And then one day he decided to learn Portuguese. So he went to a bookstore, bought a dictionary, started to read some book, translating some stuff. And then he went to Lisbon. This is in the 40s, 45, before the war, in fact, 44, I think. He went to Lisbon, okay, and then there was the tramway in Lisbon that goes, and at each stop, the driver says the name of the stop. He told, I could not understand anything. I didn't learn Portuguese at all, like, you know. Then he decided from there, because the war was almost there, decided to go to Rio. When he arrives in Rio, he was so happy, he said, oh my God, now I understand everything. So now I know Portuguese. And he lived in Brazil for 40 years. He passed away in the 90s. And he wrote a book called Como Aprendi Português e Outras Aventuras, How I Learned Portuguese and Other Adventures. He was a Hungarian. And this book is very interesting because it shows all the process. And at the end, there's a chapter about the Hungarian language. It's so fascinating. But he mentions this in the book, like when he went to Portugal, he could not understand most of the things because of what we saw here. And this is a thing I think is true. Many foreigners, they mention this as well. Even Portuguese, they say, Brazilians speak Portuguese with sugar. Okay? I tend to agree because, So the way we speak Portuguese, more like melodical. When you listen to bossa nova songs, you can see this right away. Like, it's like flowing, That's the impression that I have. I went to Portugal, I went to Azores, I went to Madeira, I went to three places, and they have different accents all over this place. Okay, I went to different parts of Portugal, different accents. And I could understand, I'd say 99% of people there. There's some phrase, like expressions, they're very local, or the way they pronounce some little, but 99%, it's not another language, Of course, you need to prepare a little bit to do your homework, to go to this, different words and stuff. And that's it. There's not a magic thing. Yeah. 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 It's easier for you, Portuguese from Portugal. For people from Spaniards, like I'd say European Portuguese would be easier because the way Spaniards pronounce Spanish is very different than the Latin American way, even the intonation change, the way, yeah, I agree with you. Yes, for you it would be easier, that's correct. Yes. Paulo Rone. Paulo Rone, R, O, acento agudo, Ró. N-A-I, Paulo Rone. Claro que, of course, Paulo is not his first name. He made this his Portuguese name in Brazil. I think it was Paul. I don't know how to write in Hungarian, Paul. Paul, yeah, Rone, yeah. So his daughter is a journalist nowadays at O Globo in Rio. Cora Rone, she's a journalist there. There is no unification. Like, so for example, when in Brazil, when you publish a Portuguese writer, we write in the Brazilian orthography. That's it. Except for Saramago, that never wanted this. So Saramago explicitly said, for my contract, if you're going to publish my books in Brazil, you must publish the way I wrote in Portugal. So that's okay. You can read. It's not, Yeah. Which one? Yeah. Yeah. Yes, that's correct. It's an evolution, but it's funny because in Rio de Janeiro, they pronounce exactly like this as well. Because in 1808, the Portuguese royal family came to Brazil escaping from the invasion of the French. Napoleon would like to invade Portugal, so they decided to bring all the family, the royal family, to Brazil. So starting in 1808, people in Brazil start to kind of mimic the way Portuguese people were talking at the time. So if you go to Rio, the carioca accent has a lot of influence from Portuguese, especially the sh sound is like sh all the time. So estou a falar, estou, meu irmão, like it's very, and the S is very pronounced in this accent in Rio. This was this influence from Portugal. We're good? So thank you very much, and I hope you can learn more Portuguese.